Today is the 50th Friday group meeting. The date is 21st April 2017. The topic name is M.K. Gandhi, the lawyer about Mahatma Gandhi's life as a lawyer in South Africa. The key speaker is Justice S. Muralidhar, Delhi High Court judge. He is going to address us on this topic. My Lord, Mr. Muralidhar, kindly address us. We are all grateful to you. Lords, I request Nakvi to read a few lines about our Muralidhar. Yeah, yes, come. The staff of the CBA.
Thank you so much.
They themselves brought this and they expressed and immediately.
They all miss you.
Yeah, please.
With sir's permission.
For a minute.
All right.
Honorable Mr. Justice S. Muralidhar began his law practice in Chennai in September 1984 and in 1987 shifted to Supreme Court of India and the Delhi High Court. He was an active lawyer for the Supreme Court Legal Services Committee and later was its member for two terms. His pro bono work included the cases for the victim of Bhopal gas disaster and those displaced by the dam on the Narmada. He was appointed as a amicus curiae by the Supreme Court in several PIL cases and in cases involving convicts on the death row. Honorable Mr. Justice Muralidhar was counsel for the National Human Rights Commission and the Election Commission of India and a part-time member of Law Commission from December 2002 till May 2006 when he was appointed as a judge of the Delhi High Court. Mr. Justice Muralidhar was awarded the PhD by the Delhi University in 2003. He is an author of Law, Poverty and Legal Aid, Access to Criminal Justice, a book published by LexinXe, Butterworth in August 2004.
Thank you very much. Murli, as usual, we have a one-by-one introduction.
All right.
Yeah, myself, Seshgiri Rao. Yeah, of course, sir.
Do we need it? Unless the rest of the group wants to know it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Amit Sharma, I had a privilege of working with sir.
Prasov Kumar Mishra.
Anil Kumar. I'm Aditya. I had the privilege of hearing sir arguing death sentence cases in chief court and other courts.
Okay.
Nithilesh Masi.
Asai Pandit.
You like
APC. With your friend. I had the opportunity to work with you.
Shikhar Pritha.
Please.
Amit Pratap Singh.
Oshim Banu.
Amit
Pratap
Singh.
Okay.
Please. Yeah. Rakesh.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, back side also, please.
All right.
Quickly.
All
right. Now, the today's topic is, all of you, even though I circulated, but still once again, the topic is M.K. Gandhi, the lawyer about Mahatma Gandhi's life as a lawyer in South Africa. That is the topic. I hope you are... Definitely you will enjoy this, Muralidhar. Thank you, Murali.
First of all, it's so happy to be back in Library 2. I can't tell you how delighted I am. In fact, Seshun and I have been talking about this for a long time. And there was some hesitation whether I should not. But I think the time at which it has happened, and his persuasion, his ultimate selling point was the 50th meeting of the Friday group. And he said, this is very important for us and you should be here. I think for those who probably are aware, I'm very happy to see very familiar faces, colleagues whom I've known for many, many years. In 1998, as part of the PhD work, I happened to spend 8 weeks. Those days, Supreme Court had proper 8-week vacation. So I spent 4 weeks in England and 4 weeks in South Africa, watching the legal aid movements there. So when I came back, I was so full of it, I said, and there was some close ring of colleagues and friends, so I said, we should share it. So I remember we sat in a table here in Library 2.
This very table?
Okay. So that went off so well that some of us said we should have this as a regular feature. So what started then continued definitely till I got appointed as a judge of the Delhi High Court. And I must give full credit to Seshu for this, for keeping the spirit alive. And I'm overwhelmed to see so many of you here who've come for this Friday meeting. And we used to, I think Nandini will remember, we used to maintain the register of all the topics and issues, continued that same practice even now. Ruksana is here, so good. I can see many familiar faces here. So it's therefore very happy to be back here. And I deliberately chose this topic because I'm sure many of you have read about even Gandhi's life as a philosopher. But there was one book that came out in 2012, which is Charles DeSalvo's The Man Before the Market. Till then, somehow nobody from the law profession had actually looked at Gandhi's life as a lawyer. Much has been written about his life in India, and they've borrowed largely from his autobiography, My Experiments with Truth. But even Gandhi himself did not write about his life as a lawyer. In fact, as I was preparing for this talk, I just tried comparing what is there in DeSalvo's book with what is there in Experiments with Truth. Gandhi talks of a very few cases. He talks about Dada Abdullah's case, which is the first major case he went for. He talks about a few other cases. But by and large, he doesn't want to discuss from his own standpoint what he did as a lawyer. And if you read DeSalvo's book, it's fascinating because you see the depth and range of Gandhi's work. And when, even in casual conversations, even with judges, when I mentioned to them that, you know, this man had 2 decades of law practice, they are surprised. They say, oh, he did have law practice. They all presume that he was a failed lawyer. So the presumption is that somehow Gandhi didn't succeed as a lawyer, which is completely contrary to the truth. And it is a tragedy that till 2012, nobody bothered to go back to collected works of Mahatma Gandhi, which is about 100 volumes, and about the enormous documents available in those collected works, which talks about Gandhi's life as a lawyer. What also helped DeSalvo was the back issues of the local newspapers of Johannesburg and Durban. So since those back issues were available, he could go back literally 100 years and see what was reported on cases. And since Gandhi was the only Indian lawyer in Durban, and we are talking of 1893, there was a curiosity about him. And so everything that happened in court was actually reported, including the dialogue that went exchanged between Gandhi and the judge. So it's actually a fascinating read. So none of you in this room should miss reading Man Before the Mahatma, what I'm going to give you today, because we have very little time compared to the breadth of Gandhi's work. Every one of you must read this book from several standpoints, which I will definitely point out later also. But it's a must read for every lawyer, and particularly lawyers working for losing causes and difficult environment. So I can identify many of the things that, the frustrations that Gandhi felt in his practice, because he was working in an openly hostile environment. At least today's situation in India is not such that, at least in Delhi, we have to face that degree of hostility about the legal system and the laws that Gandhi felt. Of course, many of us are perturbed about the way the legal system functions, about the way some of the laws are, and we are in our own personal way as lawyers trying to change that or challenge it. But his task was far more severe and far more great than we can even imagine. So I don't want to go back to the early phase of Gandhi's life, because we don't again have time. What you should know is Gandhi was not a graduate. So soon after he finished matriculation, he joined a college in Samaldas. It's called the Samaldas College in Bhavnagar. But he was a very poor student. So when he went back home in Rajkot and talked to his family friends, he had lost his father by then. One of them suggested that he should go and do bar at law in England, because they found that this would be a good earning prospect. So for purely economic considerations, and if one child, and he had elder brothers, one of whom was a pleader in Rajkot and who were not doing very well. So the family decided that they'll pool in whatever funds they have to somehow send Gandhi to London, by which time Gandhi was already married. And he talks briefly about going to Bombay and then going to London. And there's a lot of resistance by his community. Gandhi, as you know, was a Kathiawadi Baniya. And that community apparently was very strong and believed that nobody should cross the seas. So a lot of resistance to Gandhi going abroad. So very early on, since there was so much resistance, Gandhi decided he should go. So there is one streak in him that if you stop him from doing what he believes he should do, he will anyway do it. In England, he finds that the bar exams there are only a series of exams. And there are no classes, and you have to do your own reading. So, as it turns out, Gandhi was not a bad student at all when it came to studying law. And we find him mentioning what Snell's Principles of Equity, Williams' Law of Property, Broome's Common Law, William Tudor's Leading Cases. These were his standard texts. He also learnt Latin. He did an improvement of his matriculation, which he had passed in back in Gujarat. So to cut that story, because we don't have time again, on 11 June 1891, when Gandhi is not even 22, he's called to the bar in England. So on 11 June, he's called to the bar, and 12 June, he's back on the boat back to India. But that's where his trouble started, because he was not very confident. He was a barrister, all right. But even in Rajkot, he believed that he could not handle cases because he didn't know anything about the Indian law. He had studied all this common law back in England. So he was not at all confident of being able to set up practice in Rajkot. So he goes to Bombay, and there he simply waits for work. And he's told about the scenario in Bombay then about barristers not getting work unless they paid commission. So Mr. Basant will certainly not disagree with me that even today the situation is not very different. And so he finds he's not getting work. Somehow one case comes to him of a lady called Mami Bai. And he says it was a very straightforward case. All he had to do is some money claim. And it was for the asking that, you know, the case will be allowed. And the plaintiff's witness had been examined, and Gandhi had to get up to cross-examine and ask just two questions. The man was completely tongue-tied. So many juniors in this room can take heart that your experiences are not the first experience of a lawyer. Gandhi actually could not utter two sentences in court. So he had to just sit down. He had to get his client to engage another lawyer. But Gandhi being Gandhi returned the fee. And that's something perhaps some juniors here should understand. That for Gandhi, his reputation was very important. What people thought of his professionalism and his credibility was so important that he would not compromise on that. So he returns the fee, somebody else is engaged who, you know, wins the case in no time. Just two questions and cross-examination is allowed. Gandhi gets some drafting work. Now this was his skill. He was apparently very good at drafting. So he's able to draft memorials, petitions, complaints, representations. So that got him some work. And then of course he wound up in Bombay and came back to Rajkot, started helping his brother. And there the brother said, listen, unless we pay commission, we're not going to get work. So Gandhi concedes that for his brother's sake, he had to not protest about his brother paying commission for the work.
Sorry for the delay, sir.
Yeah,
it's all right.
Welcome, Vinayagam sir.
Yes. Now at that stage, a family friend suggests that there is a case going on. These are the Memons, the Kachi Memons. They had a firm in Pretoria, in Johannesburg. And they said that, if we send Gandhi there, he can help. Because it's a very complicated case involving accounts of a firm. And about dispute between two Indian firms. And if Gandhi can go there, they promised £300 being paid to him as a lump sum for the whole case. And that was a princely sum then. So Gandhi immediately agreed. Of course, there was resistance in the family. Now this first case he goes for, he has to take the boat to Durban. Because that's where the Indian settlements are. So he's received in Durban by this person called Dada Abdullah, who'd be his lifelong friend. And he has to spend some time in Durban before he travels to Pretoria. So in Durban, he goes to the court. He says, curious to know what the court is like. Dada Abdullah is not a lawyer, he's just a merchant. In fact, Dada Abdullah is not even a matriculate, but a very shrewd person. So takes Gandhi to the court. Gandhi is wearing a turban. So when he sits next to the European lawyers, as it is, there's a resistance. Although he's properly attired, as a barrister should be, but he's wearing his turban. So judge looks at him and says, you have to remove your turban. Gandhi says, no, I cannot remove my turban. So very first encounter in the court with the judge, ends in Gandhi leaving the court saying, I can't remove my turban. Ultimately, he does remove his turban, which is some years down the line. He watches the court system. He knows there's going to be a lot of hostility because he can't see a single Indian lawyer in Durban. After a few weeks in Durban, by which time he develops certain acquaintances, he goes to Johannesburg. He's got a ticket which will ultimately take him to Pretoria. And that's where the famous incident happens in Pietermaritzburg. And Gandhi refers to Stasius Maritzburg in his autobiography. I don't know, people are probably aware of this, I don't have to repeat too much of it. Basically, he buys a first class ticket. He's sitting in the first class coach. When the train reaches Maritzburg, the ticket inspector says, you can't sit in this coach, this is only for whites. And Gandhi says, I've got a first class ticket, you can't evict me. But they say, nothing doing, either you move to the third class or you're out. So they literally physically evict him from the train and he's left in the Maritzburg station, feeling deeply humiliated and hurt. Now this personal experience of being discriminated against, I think formed his convictions and his strong orientation on civil liberties. His ordeal did not end there. From Maritzburg, he goes to a place called Standerton, and from there he has to take a stagecoach to Johannesburg. On the stagecoach, although he has a ticket for sitting inside the coach, again the same problem, only whites can be seated there. So he's asked to sit up with the coach rider. There's a seat next to him. Even that seat is asked to be vacated midway, and Gandhi again this time resists. So he started, he gets assaulted by the stagecoach guy, and the passengers protest saying, don't do this. And Gandhi is holding on to the reins. You can imagine he's a frail looking person, much frailer than this and much younger than this. He's after all just about, 22 years old. So anyway, he survives that ordeal. He reaches Pretoria. And in Dada Abdullah's case, Gandhi plays an extremely important role. He learns accountancy. He's a person who does not know debit, credit, bookkeeping, nothing. He teaches himself that. He watches how senior lawyers in South Africa, white lawyers, approach the case. He learns a lot. He suggests that they go for arbitration. The arbitration award is actually in favor of his client. But the amount is so huge, he knows that the respondent will not be able to pay. So Gandhi, as a personal initiative, proposes a settlement. And the case ends in a settlement with installments being given to the respondent. So very first case that Gandhi handled, therefore, ended in a settlement with Gandhi actually facilitating mediation. And this is a famous passage, I'm sure has been read on several public platforms, where he says, it was more difficult for me to secure this concession of payment by installments than to get the parties to agree to arbitration. But both were happy over the result and both rose in the public estimation. My joy was boundless. I had learnt the true practice of law. I had learnt to find out the better side of human nature and enter men's hearts. I realized the true function of a lawyer was to unite parties riven asunder. The lesson was indelibly burnt into me that a large part of my time during the 20 years of my practice as a lawyer was occupied in bringing about private compromises of hundreds of cases. I lost nothing thereby, not even money, certainly not my soul. And we are talking of 1893 in an alien country in a hostile atmosphere where the system is against you, the laws are against you, and he's restoring the dignity of two Indian merchants who've been fighting over money. So it's a remarkable achievement for lawyers as young as Gandhi was at that stage. And this would form the philosophy and his approach to legal practice. Although he was a good adversarial lawyer, at every possible stage, if there was a possibility of forging a settlement, Gandhi would intervene and get it done. And this was not just about litigation between private parties. It's also about, issues with the state, with whichever was the government, whichever was the administration at that point in time. And this was a running theme of his life as a lawyer. When he comes back after the Dada Abdullah case is over, basically he had gone to South Africa only for that. So he was all ready to come back home. He said, this is what I came for. So they give him a party in Durban. the Indian merchants are very happy. But he notices in the newspaper that a new law has been passed to restrict the voting rights of Indians. So he draws their attention to that and says, I'm not going to do something about this. How can they treat you like this? You're also British citizens. You must remember that Indians prided themselves as British citizens then. In fact, Gandhi himself argued many of these positions initially in South Africa as a British citizen. He believed the British system could not discriminate amongst its citizens. So then the Indian merchants were clueless because none of them was lettered, none of them knew how to read a statute, none of them knew how to petition the government. So they all agreed to pool in their resources and told Gandhi, if you can stay back and you can help us fight this, then you know, we are ready to take care of your expenses. And that public service spirit of Gandhi is, you know, evident here when he says, well, as long as you can bear my basic expenses, I'm prepared to do this. So Gandhi stays back. That whole petition that he writes, thousands of signatures are collected, almost 10,000 signatures, he says. But thousands of signatures are collected and a petition is sent to London. Lord Ripon is the Governor General, and they petition him as Indian citizens, but nothing comes of it. They go ahead and anyway pass the law because it's a very hostile place and they don't want to see Indians getting equal rights as Europeans. Indians were basically three or four communities. There were the Mohammedans, there were Parsis, and there were the Hindu clerks. And then there was indentured labor. Indentured labor basically came from Bihar, Bengal, and from the Madras Presidency. So there were a lot of Telugu-speaking people, Tamil-speaking people. In fact, Gandhi's eagerness to learn Tamil, I don't know if there are many Tamil-speaking today here. So Gandhi taught himself to write Tamil. Yes, and he could even read Tamil, but he could not speak it very well. And this he learned in South Africa. He was so moved by the earnestness and sincerity of the Telugu-speaking and Tamil-speaking people that he says somewhere in his autobiography that he always had a soft spot for them. But he also learned Urdu later in his life. Telugu he apparently learned to read and write, but not to speak. So he uses that experience to write up what is called a green paper on the struggles in South Africa, of Indians in South Africa. So one of his first visits back to India from South Africa was in 1896. And he thought he's going to come back to India for good. But in India, he met up with Gokhale. And Gokhale advised him about his strategy as far as espousing the cause of Indians in South Africa. So this green pamphlet that he wrote, Gandhi got it printed. He took it to Pune. He took it to Madras. He held meetings. There's also an episode of how Sir Firoz Shah Mehta organizes a meeting for Gandhi in Bombay. And Gandhi is too nervous to speak. So when his turn comes to speak, he's so nervous he can't even read out the speech. They have to call out somebody else from the audience to read out the speech. Later, of course, Gandhi was a master orator, but that was much later. Initially, he was very tentative. He was very nervous. He was very good in what he wrote, but he was not a very good speaker. And he overcame these limitations. He overcame these fears. And one person who comes to mind is Palkhivala himself. If you remember reading Palkhivala's autobiography, Palkhivala had a very pronounced stammer. And you had to work hard at overcoming that stammer. So, and of course, became a brilliant exponent of oral advocacy. So Gandhi returns to South Africa because the Indian community in Durban writes to him saying, you know, there is some development happening on the political front, we need your help. So he returns to South Africa in 1896 itself, and that forms the second phase in his what is called the Natal province phase. There are two basic provinces in South Africa at that time. One is the Transvaal province, where Johannesburg and Pretoria are, which is the southern part of South Africa. The other is the eastern part where Durban is. Port Elizabeth is on the eastern coast, Durban is above that. And Durban has a very large Indian population. So the first phase of his life as a lawyer in South Africa, as a barrister, was in Durban. And he picked up a very good practice. Now, how did he pick up this practice? There were two or three issues that always would engage him. One was filing ordinary suits on promissory notes between merchants. So Gandhi was very good in commercial law and in civil law. He occasionally used to do criminal cases. One case that stands out, and probably Mrs. Kalpakaram is aware of it, was the case of one indentured labor called Balasundaram, who's obviously Tamil speaking. Balasundaram was beaten up so badly. Basically, indentured labor is like domestic help, treated as slaves who have no rights. So they're actually treated as property, as chattel, and can be traded across, you know, persons. And he comes to Gandhi's office, and Gandhi teams up with a local lawyer and he shares an office space. So this man's turban is bleeding, and because of the caste system, which again Gandhi speaks of, when he enters Gandhi's office, he removes the turban, and Gandhi finds that the turban is bleeding, and he preserves the turban as a proof of the injuries caused. And he files, apart from a police complaint, he also files a case before the local magistrate. So it's a simultaneous, you know, proceedings that Gandhi starts. And he finds that there will be a problem because it's a pure contractual arrangement. While you might succeed in the criminal case, you might actually not get relief to the person because he's not going to get any, you know, return of wages or employment. So after filing the case, Gandhi negotiates with the local administration and gets the person who is employing that indentured labor to transfer it to another person whom Gandhi knows. And because of Gandhi's reputation as a lawyer by this time, some European came forward and said, okay, I can take him. And that way Balasundaram could get relief. Following Balasundaram, Gandhi helped a large number of indentured labor with their troubles. And there was always this backdoor negotiation that Gandhi would undertake, because he knows that he's working in a hostile legal environment where it's not easy to get orders implemented. And there's no strict separation between the court and the administration. The court is also filled with white people, so is the administration. Gandhi applies to the Supreme Court in Natal for admission as a barrister. There's a fierce resistance put up by the local bar, saying, how can you have a foreign lawyer enrolled? And Gandhi produces his Bharat Law certificate, a copy of it, because the original has been filed in the Bombay High Court where he got enrolled as a barrister. He produces a copy of that and a certificate issued by the Bombay High Court that he's been enrolled. The local attorney general there helps Gandhi by saying, well, if you can get a certificate, a reference of good conduct from your own community, that might help. So Gandhi has to, you know, bite that insult, saying, why should my community have to certify for me when I'm a lawyer? After all, I'm getting seeking admission to the Supreme Court. But he bites that insult. And like he says, he uses that phrase, pockets the insult. And he produces that certificate, he's admitted to the bar in Natal. And Gandhi had a very good practice. Not all the cases he was able to be successful, but he picked up cases of rickshawwalas. There was a strong law of permitting rickshaw pulling only to the non-Indians. Wherever the Indians were industrious, wherever they were able to earn, like hawkers, Indians were very good hawkers, Indians were very good tradesmen, Indians were very good labor, and they were posing an open challenge to the Europeans. So the Europeans found they were increasingly getting dependent on the Indians, and they were resentful. So you find it's a deja vu. If you look at the policies abroad now, there's always a resentment about immigration. So even then, South Africa was resisting this kind of immigration, and Indians always came in large numbers. So one of Gandhi's basic tasks was to make sure that the laws are not changed to the disadvantage of the Indians. As it is, their voting rights were curtailed. There were also what is called zoning laws, that Indians could live only in certain areas, could only undertake certain occupations. So there was a constant struggle of, you know, writing up petitions, petitioning the British government in London, asking that, you know, such harsh laws should be done away with. You must also realize at this stage that at that time, and we're talking of pre-1899, South Africa, that part of South Africa, Transvaal, where Johannesburg, Pretoria, was still under the control of what are called the Boers. That is the Afrikaners. And there was a war between England and the British and the Afrikaners, called the Boer War. And Gandhi volunteered his services on the side of the British. The British won that war, and the Indians took a conscious decision that they will support the British in that war, and Gandhi was part of it. He was also part of the ambulance corps. To their dismay, when British people took over in 1899, they continued these laws and made it worse for the Indians. So the Indians felt completely betrayed that having supported the British, they were not any better off. So the first phase saw Gandhi handle a lot of cases, established himself as a good lawyer, doing regular, and all of this activity that Gandhi did on the political front was simultaneous with his handling of small cases of ordinary people in the courts. And when you're around the courts, when you're there every day, whether you lose or win doesn't matter, but you gain a reputation. People know that you're honest, you're sincere, and you know, you will not lie in the court. And Gandhi was uncompromising as far as speaking the truth was concerned. While he didn't think that you know, there should be a confession of guilt, he felt that he will not present in the court something which is not true about the case, which is a remarkable quality. It's walking that very thin line between how much a lawyer can go as far as professional ethics is concerned. There is one instance of a witness, his own client, breaking down in the witness box because his lies are exposed. Gandhi immediately closes the case then and there, says the client will pay the fine. He says somewhere he always felt that he should not be defending a position which is indefensible and not push a point beyond, you know, what is permissible. So the in 1899 he comes back on a visit to India, and this time he's slightly better off. Again, he has plans only to come back to India, not go back to South Africa. He goes back to practicing for about 6 months in Bombay in the 1900s. At that time, his political activity in India also increases. By now, it's known that Gandhi stands for the Indians in South Africa. So his immediate circle included Gokhale, and he came to Calcutta. He spent time with Surendranath Banerjee. Of course, he was very close to Gokhale. Gokhale was like his mentor, giving him advice on how he should proceed to espouse the cause of Indians. He also visits the Congress meeting in Calcutta, and he's dismayed to find how disorganized it is. He's dismayed to find that everybody delegates tasks to everybody else. So the real worker is some lowly person, and he finds there's a very strong caste system. There's untouchability practiced, even, you know, the meeting venue. And all this disturbs him. He meets Tilak, and he meets Annie Besant. Annie Besant was a very strong influence on Gandhi during these years because he had heard her speeches in London as part of the Theosophical School. And Gandhi had a very close association with Theosophists, although he himself was not a Theosophist. He again travels by third class. And this is very interesting. He says, I want to see the country by traveling in third class. So when he visits in 1900 itself, he develops this habit of traveling in the, you know, compartment which is the most inconvenient, because he wants to see how ordinary people live. And I think this comes from his experience in that one train journey, even in South Africa, where this class distinction, class discrimination affects him very deeply at a personal level. Again, when his practice is picking up in Bombay, he gets a letter again from South Africa saying they need his help there. So his heart is somewhere in South Africa. He feels he has an unfinished task that he can't, you know, let go. Now this time when he comes back to South Africa, Gandhi decides that he has to make a very conscious decision whether he wants to continue as a barrister in Durban, because his presence, I must mention this, that Gandhi is one of the founding members of the Natal Indian Congress. He actually forms this political party even while he's in practice in Durban. But things are happening with the British government taking over all of South Africa. There is a restriction of movement of Indians from Natal to Transvaal and Transvaal to Natal. And Gandhi feels that he should do something about this. And while he was defending cases of people trying to enter Transvaal and not being able to re-enter Natal, he felt that if he was in Transvaal, he'll be able to organize the community far better. So he makes a very conscious decision that he will shift his practice to Transvaal. Now there is a difficulty here. While he could practice as a barrister in Durban, in Transvaal the rules were very rigid. In 1902, an Administration of Justice Ordinance had been passed, by which there was clear distinction between attorneys and advocates, like you had in India, like in Bombay till independence and Calcutta maybe. So you had to choose whether you wanted to be an attorney or an advocate. And the rules of admission to the bar as a barrister in Transvaal was going to be next to impossible, because it was all whites bar and they would refuse admission. So as a very strategic, conscious decision, Gandhi decides to apply for admission as an attorney and succeeds. what this meant was he could appear in the lower courts, but not in the Supreme Court and the High Court. And this is a sacrifice he was prepared to make for the larger interests of the Indian community. So this move to go to Transvaal was a very, very significant shift in Gandhi's strategy on the political front as well. So he is granted application on 14th April 2003 in the Transvaal Bar, and he opens his office in a very busy locality in Johannesburg called Rizik Street. Gandhi's practice picks up remarkably. He is the only Indian lawyer working for the Indian community. There are a large number of Indian merchants. He starts earning money much more than he imagined he would. But being Gandhi, he diverts that money into the Indian Opinion. So this newspaper that he ran, and he wrote prodigiously about local issues, about the struggles of Indians. So where he found the time, where he found the energy is amazing. And he was just above in his early 30s when this happened. He was 34. And a remarkable production of writing. And he read extensively. He extensively read philosophy, you know, law of course he read, jurisprudence and literature. And religious and spiritual texts. And religious texts, not just the Hindu religious texts, but religious texts across religions. So all of this went into shaping his thinking, his personality. And he experimented with himself too, about abstention, about fasting, about silences. So you find the man has struggles on several fronts, struggles within himself, struggles in the community, struggles with the administration, struggles in the bar, struggles with the law, struggles with the legal system. But all of these struggles are making him very spiritually strong and internally poised and equanimous. He has a few victories in Transvaal too, but I'm going to focus on one remarkable case that Gandhi took up as a test litigation. We're talking of 1906, and this is February 1906. Electric trams were started for the first time in Johannesburg. And till then, the tram system was the stage carriage system, where horses would pull the carriages. And now it was electric trams. There was a clear segregation. If you were an Indian, you could enter a European car, a tram car, only if you went as a servant of a European, and not on your own. And even if you entered the tram car, you had to sit in the rear or sometimes on top of the tram car. All of this was great humiliation. So when the electric tram car was introduced, the local town council there decided that they will have the same segregation continued. They will have an all-European tram car and all-colored tram car. But that all-colored tram car didn't materialize, so decided to continue the earlier system of permitting Indians to board the tram cars only if they were servants of Europeans. Now, Gandhi had a very novel way of approaching the whole issue. He asked a wealthy Indian businessman, accompanied by Gandhi's own law clerk, a very young white person, to deliberately board a European tram car and court arrest. So the minute he courted arrest, Gandhi filed a complaint against the conductor, because Gandhi studied the local traffic laws and found that under the local traffic laws, it was an offense for a conductor to deny a passenger admission to a tram car. So there were two laws conflicting with each other. One is the traffic law, which mandated that the conductor should admit a passenger. And the other is this ordinance, which came about on colored segregation of colored and Europeans as far as use of tram car was concerned. So when the case went up, Gandhi could immediately point out that this was an infraction of the traffic law. So it ended up with the conductor getting punished. Within a few days thereafter, he made the same person, that is Kuvadia, a wealthy Indian businessman, to board another tram car. And this case again he succeeded. So in quick succession, there were two cases using the weakness in the law, but demonstrating the unjustness of it. So the local community therefore reacted very violently. And I don't know if people who followed the civil rights movement in the US, the famous incident of Rosa Parks, where a strategy was evolved to make Rosa Parks not get up from the front row seat in the bus in the US, in Alabama. And when she refused to vacate, she was forcibly thrown out. There was a bus boycott which started for one day and continued for a whole year. it's a famous incident, and that ultimately got challenged, and you had a US Supreme Court verdict saying there cannot be segregation in buses. Very similar strategy Gandhi adopted in 1906, which is not known to many of us, that this was actually a test litigation that he was commencing. So as a violent reaction to this, what they did was repeal the traffic bylaw, which meant only the other ordinance which segregated the tram cars would remain. So the third and fourth attempt by Gandhi did not succeed because they did not prosecute the person who violated the ordinance. But this was an important strategy because it got wide coverage in the press. I must also tell you that Gandhi used the media very effectively. Since he was a good writer, he could write petitions. He was also the news. Gandhi was the news and creator of the news and also the purveyor of the news. So a lot of the local newspapers in South Africa reported on everything that Gandhi did. So it got a lot of publicity, these two cases, and put him in a very, very important position in Transvaal. Of course, the local administration was hostile to him. They tried various ways of, you know, intimidating him. I didn't refer to one serious incident of intimidation which Gandhi faced when he came back to India from India in 1896. The ship was quarantined because he was coming with a large number of Indians, and the local whites in Durban were resenting it. They said they would lynch Gandhi if he ever got off the ship. They managed to get the ship quarantined for about 23 days. But at the end of the 23rd day, Gandhi insisted on disembarking. So Gandhi actually gets lynched when he walks with another white barrister. But there is a Mrs. Alexander, a white lady, who rescues him, literally rescues him, and takes him home, gets him treated. He uses a disguise to escape from her house and goes away, and that's another incident. Similarly, in Transvaal, he gets attacked, this time by the Indians themselves. And the issue is this: there is a law made in Transvaal that Indians have to register, and register with all their 10 fingerprints. So you can imagine that Gandhi was the first person to resent it, because he said this hits at our self-respect and dignity. He treats everyone having to give fingerprints as criminals. Only criminals are asked to give fingerprints. Why should Indians give it? The argument of the local administration was, well, if you have nothing to fear, why don't you register yourself? Gandhi's problem was with the compulsion. If you did not register, you would be punished. So they would deport forcibly people who refused to register. Now that's the beginning of what is called the civil disobedience movement. Gandhi felt very strongly that nobody should volunteer to register, because this is a compulsory law. And there's a whole phase of Gandhi's life in Transvaal where at two fronts he meets this law. One is by actually pleading guilty, making people plead guilty and go to jail. So this jail baro movement that we see here had its origins in what Gandhi did in South Africa. And he kept petitioning, he kept writing memorials, he kept writing complaints about the huge discrimination that Indians were facing as a result of having to compulsory register. And there was also what is called as personal suffering. When he found that many of these tactics did not work, I must mention the case of one Ram Sundar Pandit. He's basically a Purohit who travelled from India and went to Durban to work as a Purohit. And he used to perform all the rituals for the Indian community there. He then moved to Transvaal. Now this Ram Sundar Pandit was also a good speaker. So he joined hands with Gandhi in questioning many of the discriminatory practices against Indians. So he was a marked figure. He also refused to register. So when he refused to register, he was arrested, and Gandhi defended him at the trial. Interestingly, since Ram Sundar Pandit did not renew his permit, they charged him with staying illegally in South Africa without a permit. In the cross-examination of the person who is in charge of the registration, Gandhi was able to demonstrate that the failure to renew the permit was only because Ram Sundar Pandit had opposed the law, that he had gone vocal, and the person registering had been instructed by the administration not to renew the permit because this was a person who was a political opponent. So Gandhi could demonstrate in that magistrate's court that the reason for not renewal of permit was extraneous to the actual powers of the person to renew or not renew a permit. Now, interestingly, this was in the stage where there was no constitutional law, there was no administrative law, there is only, you know, these ordinances that Gandhi has to deal with. But the man's civil liberties orientation is so strong that he could go into the motives behind an order. So now we argue in law and administrative law about motive and foundation. But Gandhi could lead the seats for it, even in a court which was non-constitutional, even in a magistrate's court, he was able to show that the order was biased, or it was motivated, or that it was malafide. It is a different thing that the magistrate did not accept the argument. But all of this was happening in public. See, what Gandhi was doing through these cases, when he was forcing people as a lawyer to admit to their guilt in some cases, to resist, the charge in some other cases, was to use the court space to demonstrate the unjustness of the law. And every time there was a conviction, the impression that anybody had, including media there, was all of this was unjust and unfair. And Gandhi successfully therefore used this court space as a democratic space for dissent, for challenge, although there was no provision to strike down laws, although there was no provision to challenge legislation. Here is a man who thought ahead of his times and saw that a courtroom could be a space where your struggle could extend. So this I found as a fascinating aspect of his life as a lawyer. Of course, he was getting disillusioned. He said, this system is so inherently unjust that it will be pointless going on filing cases and making people undertake sacrifices. So on three occasions, Gandhi himself violated the registration law and courted arrest, and he was imprisoned on three different occasions in South Africa. Once between October and November 2007, once again between January and May 2008, and between October and December 1908. He also fought cases for conscientious objectors during this time. You must also remember that he was writing in the Indian Opinion and was also fighting the regular cases. And Gandhi had apparently a huge practice in South Africa. He had four clerks, one article clerk, one secretary. So, and he believed in perfect etiquette, very courteous in court. So all the exchanges that he has with his opponents or with the judge, you'll find a lot of courtesy, a lot of calm, and always smiling in court. So even when an adverse order is passed, Gandhi is smiling. So the reporter is fascinated by the fact that he is a smiling lawyer. Very often, you neither find a smiling lawyer nor a smiling judge. So this is another tactic that a person can use. You can learn usefully that when everything is against you, you can disarm with a smile. And the other person who's, vehemently opposed to you, it could even be the judge, will pause before, continuing in that manner. In 2010, sometime in 2010, he takes a definite decision. Sorry, 1910, he takes a definite decision that he wants to quit practice and come back to India. And this is almost 20 years after he began his life as a lawyer in South Africa. I think law taught Gandhi a lot, because it told him that you can have the power of the law by your side in difficult situations when everything else is failing. And you can have that occasional, good day in court where things can change. And you can keep the people's hopes alive. When Balasundaram's case succeeded in the way it did, it gave hopes to the indigenous labor. And they supported Gandhi in great numbers when the political struggle happened. Indian merchants again, he fought for hawkers, not only the wealthy merchants, but also for the hawkers. Likewise, he dealt with the whole cross-section of Indian population there. So he earned the respect of not only the Indian population, but he also earned the respect of the bar there. He was the only colored lawyer for many, many years. And somehow he earned the respect of his peers and of judges. So you have occasions of these dialogues in Disselbo's book, but the judge is very respectful to Gandhi. He says, yeah, I understand where you come from. I understand this is a political struggle for you. And Gandhi is, in a typical way, says, give me the highest punishment. And don't stop with any lenient punishment. You should do your duty. So he puts a lot of pressure on the judge to act unjustly. I don't know how many of you have seen this wonderful film called justice at Nuremberg.
Yeah.
Among the Nuremberg trials, there was one trial involving judges, where judges were in the dock. These were judges who were holding courts during the Nazi era. And they believed they were enforcing the rule of law. And when everything changed, the judges who were found administering that unfair law were themselves accused of siding with that horrible Nazi regime. So there is a point where judges may believe that they're doing justice in accordance with law, but politically things might change, where later on in history it is demonstrated that what you were doing was not justice in accordance with law. I think Gandhi was playing to that psychology of these judges. And he continued that when he came to India. You will remember that Gandhi faced sedition trials in India too. And in the courts, Gandhi is one who faced a lot of contempt of court proceedings, and he also faced sedition trial, just like Tilak had. And again, he used the same tactic of passive resistance, even inside the courtroom, where he would plead guilty and he would ask for the maximum sentence, saying that is what he should do. And his strategy was to show how unfair the court was, how unfair the law was, and how sometimes the court has no option in the face of such an unfair law. So this challenging of the law itself and the legal system itself is something that Gandhi realized very early on. He found that the imperial power used the court system to advance its agenda. So very often you can find an executive using the court system, using the parliamentary system to achieve its ends, and that is why you need a strong and independent judiciary. I think the whole of Gandhi's life as a lawyer tells us why it is important to have an independent judiciary, why it is important to have this shield, the judge acting, the court as acting as a shield between an oppressive regime and an oppressed, you know, citizenry. I think I should just summarize what I gather from Gandhi's two-decade life as a lawyer. One is, he told us how to practice in a hostile environment, where the system is against you, the laws are against you, even in the bar there is no support, and even the people for whom you are standing in front are not sure whether they have a case or not. So when you think of what is happening in India, there are many pockets in India where people believe they don't have access to justice. And I must say, even in this room, there are lawyers standing up for such people. You may have a rough day in court, but you can't give up. Just like Gandhi refused to give up. He knew he was losing case after case because the law is very plain and simple. And if you strictly applied the law, you would always fall on the wrong side of the law. Like when you argue for, you know, slum dwellers in this country, the first question you'll be asked is, what right do you have as a slum dweller? But you don't stop with that, right? You try and forge your arguments in terms of the Constitution. So there will be many situations in the court where you think the law itself is against. You may want as a strategy to challenge the law which is unjust. And in our Indian legal system today, that option is available, certainly available to challenge the law itself. Second was, there was no excuses for lack of professionalism. Gandhi believed that you must be a thorough professional. He was an expert at drafting memorials, drafting petitions, and he learnt it the hard way. And there's one wonderful passage from a speech given by Mr. H.R. Gokhale when he was a law minister. He says, Gandhiji fairly admitted, he says, this is what Gandhi says in the Indian Opinion, Young India. I do wish as a practiced draftsman to warn writers of petitions, whether they be pleaders or otherwise, to think of the cause they may be espousing for the time being. I assure them that a bare statement of facts, unembellished with adjectives, is far more eloquent and effective than a narrative flowing with exuberant language. And this, he says, he learned from Dadabhai Nauroji, who always impressed on him, if he wanted to be heard, he must be brief, must write to the point, and adhere to facts, must never travel beyond the cause under notice, and that he should be most sparing in his adjectives. So I think this is an advice to all lawyers and definitely to judges, that we must not say more than what is necessary, and we must not use adjectives. So this was a golden advice that Gandhiji had for lawyers. Then the power of the pen. This man wrote profusely. He wrote everything that was happening, the importance of documenting. And many of us as lawyers should realize the importance of documenting. The cases that you lose are perhaps more important than the cases you win. You should remember this. Let's say you work very hard on a PIL, collecting a lot of documents, and it got thrown out in 2 minutes in the court for some reason. It is not a waste. It's another moment in legal history. It requires to be documented. It must be put in the public domain. I would urge every lawyer here who's doing public interest cases not to privatize the information that you've gathered for that public interest litigation. If it is a true public interest litigation, you must not hesitate to share that petition with everyone. You open your own blog, now you can scan documents, put it on that blog. It should be available in the public domain. Somebody in future can learn from that mistake, if it is a mistake. Somebody in future will know, okay, this is the strategy adopted, which failed, but we should learn from. Gandhi's life tells us that all his failed cases taught him more and more about the law. He never saw failures as failures. The failure and success in the courtroom is just one moment. But it's a very, very important moment in development of the law. If you don't fail, how are you going to re-agitate that? So even in a lawyer's life, the cases that you lose are more important in shaping you as a lawyer than the cases you win. In fact, you may win on a narrow technical point and you can gloat that you won. But heart of hearts, you will know which are the cases you really fought and won and which are the cases that you feel very strongly about but you've lost. So use that opportunity to, you know, develop more as a lawyer, and that's what he did throughout. He never took his defeats lying down. He got more strength from his defeats than his successes. And in his reaction in the Indian opinion and in Young India to cases that have succeeded or failed, there's an equanimity over the man. He's not gloating that he won. He's not, you know, sad that he lost. He's learning something from that experience. He's an excellent in strategy. So he always has multi-pronged strategy, because he knows that the court is not the only point of success or failure. He knows that he's going to use the court for a certain purpose. And that strategy has worked well for Gandhi. He's scathing about the legal profession as he found it then. And I must read a passage and you'll ask me, is it any different now? This is from Law and Lawyers, which is actually an extract from several passages from my experiments with truth. This is about lawyers. Okay. The economic drain that law courts cause has at no time been considered. Yet it is not a trifle. Every institution founded under the present system is run on a most extravagant scale. Law courts are probably the most extravagantly run. I have some knowledge of the scale in England, a fair knowledge of the Indian, and an intimate knowledge of the South African. I have no hesitation in saying that the Indian is comparatively the most extravagant and bears no relation to the general economic condition of the people. I don't know how many of you visited the court in Lucknow. You have? The High Court at Lucknow? Okay.
The new one.
Yes. The best South African lawyers, and there are lawyers of great ability, dare not charge the fees the lawyers in India do. 15 guineas is almost a top fee for the legal opinion. Several thousand rupees have been known to be charged in India. There is something sinful in a system under which it is possible for a lawyer to earn from 50,000 to 1 lakh rupees per month. This is the year 1920. All right. Some lawyers will be wondering, why am I undercharging now? Legal practice ought not to be a speculative business. The best legal talent must be available to the poorest at reasonable rates. But we have copied and improved upon the practice of the English lawyers. Englishmen find the climate of India trying. The habits imbued under a cold and severe climate are retained in India. Ample margin is kept for frequent migrations to the hills and to their island home, and an equal ample margin is kept for education and exclusion aristocrat type for the children. The scale of their fees is naturally therefore pitched very high, but India cannot bear the heavy drain. We fancy that in order to feel equal of the to order to feel the equals of the English lawyers, we must charge the same killing fees that the English do. It would be a sad day for India if it has to inherit the English scale and the English taste so utterly unsuitable to the Indian environment. And the advice he has for lawyers is interesting. Put your talents in the service of the country. You must also realize that in the freedom struggle, one of Gandhi's biggest pitches was that lawyers should abandon law practice. But he said when you go on strikes and you abandon law practice, you better form your own tribunals so that justice is not denied to the people. And that part, I think lawyers have conveniently forgotten. So when we go on strikes, we paralyze the entire court system for days on end. Put your talents in the service of the country instead of converting them into pounds, shillings. If you are a medical man, there is a disease enough in India to need all your medical skill. If you're a lawyer, there are differences and quarrels enough in India. Instead of fomenting more trouble, patch up those quarrels and stop litigation. Then he says, let these lawyers be proud of their poverty, which will probably be their lot now. That is, lawyers who give up practice in the freedom struggle. Let them remember Thoreau saying that possession of riches is a crime and poverty a virtue under an unjust administration. This is an eternal maxim for the Satyagrahis. The disbarred lawyers have a rare opportunity of so remodeling their lives that it can always be above water. Let them remember that the practice of law ought not to mean taking more daily than, say, a village carpenter's wage. The other important thing is Gandhi is a pioneer of the test case strategy. That is, which kind of cases to pick up. So when he knew that in the tram car case that there was a weakness in the law, he could demonstrate that this was an unjust system. So that test case strategy is very important. When you file it, where you file it, and how you, pursue it. There was advocacy inside and outside the court. So the lawyer's task, as he saw it, in public service, did not end with simply filing petitions and arguing cases. So here was a man who wrote up a lot of, representations, memorials for the administration. So went far beyond just practice in courts. There was a firm belief in truth, completely non-compromising. In this Law and Lawyers and in Experiments of Truth, he talks of a case of a Parsi Rustamji, an Indian businessman, who got caught smuggling. And because he came to Gandhiji, he told Gandhiji, listen, they have actually caught me smuggling. So you are the one to rescue me. But because he was able to come clean, he asked Parsi Rustamji to actually come clean, write out everything that happened. He goes to the customs collector himself and argues his case, saying this is a person who's penitent for what he has done. So don't send him to jail, double his penalty. So that he succeeds. So the power of truth, and he says Parsi Rustamji framed the statement that he wrote out that day and kept it in the walls of his office to constantly remind himself that, he should not be doing this. So Gandhi inspired that kind of a behavior among clients just because he stood for principles. So you don't have to be afraid if you're a young lawyer in this room that some people are making good in the profession because of unethical practices, and therefore you should copy that. You will always be respected for your ethical practice. In this bar room, if somebody walks in to ask who are the honest lawyers, even the dishonest lawyers will tell them who the honest lawyers are. So it's always possible to find in any bar, in anywhere in this country, who are the lawyers who believe in ethics and, professional practices, and who are the ones who don't. And ultimately, some clients will always want an ethical lawyer. See, clients also are very discerning. They will know which lawyer will work for what kind of a case. There will be always a client who's been wronged, who's not necessarily in the wrong, and who will want a lawyer who fights for his case, irrespective of what the court is or who the opponent is. So your turn will come, and there is space in the bar for that honest lawyer, so don't give up. Court is a place for practicing politics. Gandhi saw this as a democratic open space. Believed in the power of public reasoning. So when he argued what may seem as a political speech before a magistrate's court, he knew he was talking to the mind of the person and the conscience of the judge. So a conscientious judge might respond to it. You never know. And the whole world is watching. The media is watching. The people are watching. So what you say in that court becomes very, very significant. And whom are you standing up for? You can't compromise the politics of the person you're standing up for. That is very, very important. And you find this throughout in Gandhi's life as a lawyer, that he doesn't compromise on the politics of his clients. civil disobedience, of course, is a huge contribution of Gandhiji to political life world over. He had inspired Martin Luther King Jr. In fact, Martin Luther King Jr. has spoken about it, written about it, about how much of an influence Gandhi was on the civil rights movement, which was another passive resistance movement. And much later, you had Nelson Mandela, who was also inspired by Gandhi. Incidentally, Nelson Mandela and Gandhi were incarcerated in the same prison, on the ruins of which today's South African Constitutional Court stands. So it's a very, very significant building, which has a historical significance, that two of the major, you know, leading lights of the two countries, India and South Africa, had something common to share in that space. What I also find very, very inspiring is an amazing courage and fearlessness. This frail man, I mean, would he be a threat to anyone at all? But he was. Literally, people started shivering their boots when they know that Gandhi is around, because they have to better have good answers. Because his power of reasoning and logic, and the firm belief in his convictions. If he knew something was unjust, he was not going to compromise on that. So, and since he was steadfast, you see, there is something that the inner resolve, the steel of the person that you say. It has nothing to do with the physical gait or appearance. It has nothing to do with the power of your lungs. It is just the sheer courage of your convictions. And this is one leading example of how you don't have to be a towering personality, you don't have to be attractive, you don't have to be striking, you don't have to be a phenomenal speaker, but by your sheer conduct, by who you are, you inspire. And you inspire several generations of people. So I think we missed out, I think in our growing years as law students and lawyers, an introduction to Gandhi's life as a lawyer. I'm sure it would have inspired many of us to do far more and far better, and give up what we thought was, you know, something that will further our careers in law. Looking at law as a career, looking at law as a public service, that distinction comes very clear in Gandhi's life as a lawyer. His decision to give up his practice as a barrister, where he was making a lot of money, and to come to being an attorney. It's like being an, you know, senior advocate or arguing counsel and say, no, I'll do chamber practice. I mean, that is a real shift which nobody can easily make. And when you're in your full faculties and you're going in your full steam. But Gandhi found that he was not a loser. He actually used that to appear in the lowest courts and actually make a mark even there. And he could make a huge influence in the way the administration behaved. Although it was hostile to them, they could not ignore it. That distinction of law as a career, of personal progression, and law as a public service, you're taking the community along, you're taking, you know, your entire people along. That is a huge thing that we can learn from Gandhi's life. He generally took people along, he was a natural leader. And since he was courageous, he was fearless, he inspired a lot of people to fall in line. So, and that explains, this life of Gandhi as a lawyer explains all his later strategies in India, of civil disobedience, of the Dandi March, of Champaran, all of that. You can see where his strength came from. And he believed that one person could make a change, and personally changed. He never preached what he did not practice. The other thing was, he was very open. All his failings, today we're able to criticize Gandhi because he wrote all that he was. We can now point to his writing and say, look, he's prejudiced against the Africans here. But later in life, he regrets that. So you can also see, if you study the collective works, of the evolution of the man. All his personal prejudices, his frailties, how he overcomes them. In fact, that's why he calls them his experiments with truth. So, thank you very much.
Great inspiration. Now we realize how Indian judiciary elevated you. Now I seriously, I can say that. It's a great man, great personality, great judge. Let us give a standing ovation.
Yeah, yeah. Line up, please.
Yes.
Thanks,
so, now I request Anam to give you a vote of thanks, Amanda.
No, should we have some questions? I can take.
Yeah, yeah, questions, Amanda. Yeah, any questions, please, now, I mean, you have.
One question. No. First, I must thank you.
You can focus him.
No. Not because. I must thank you for crossing that invisible barrier between bar and bench, which you have defied. So, not only do you defy the barrier between bar and bench, you have also been defying the process of aging. You still look as young as when you were here in Japan. So congratulations for that. Now, one very interesting thing, when Gandhi, period of Gandhi, when Gandhi was asked by his brother to go to Mumbai and Bombay then and practice in Bombay court. So he was quite dissatisfied and in fact sort of disgusted with his with his response to the legal system. In fact, he notes at one place that my brother said that I must go to the courtroom and see the proceeding, and I go off to sleep and I'm very disappointed. And then he said that next day I try to stay up, but then next day I find that my two other colleagues were sleeping next to me, and then I was not so disappointed, and then I also went off to sleep. So
this was the first phase of Gandhi's coming back to Bombay. The second phase was different. The second phase, when he set up office, he actually picked up good work. That second phase was after he had already been a lawyer in Durban for some years, for 2-3 years. So that phase was different. He went back in 1901 only because the community in Durban wanted him back. Otherwise, he would have well continued in Bombay and he was picking up work.
And the other thing was that when he had gone to Bombay,
this incident of sleeping in the court was in 1896. The first 1891, when he came back from England.
And is it true that when he went to South Africa, he was primarily employed to do the translation work, because a lot of documents that were involved in
it was not only translation work, but primarily, it was also translation.
And then how he discovers from those documents that there's a possibility of settlement, and
in fact his client's case is very strong. See, these are Memans, and Gandhi is a Gujarati. He understands the community. He says for that community not to be able to pay up is like suicide. They can't stand bankruptcy. They'd rather commit suicide than be declared bankrupt. He wants to protect the dignity of both sides. This is a remarkable man. I mean, he's far more than we can imagine. He knows his client has a good case. At the same time, he's convincing his client, do you want another Indian merchant in South Africa to face humiliation? So that is how he is able to forge a settlement, although he has a very strong case and they win in that arbitration. The award is in his favor of his client.
Let us give another opportunity. Please.
Yeah. Is there any insight on how Gandhi had developed the habit of walking very fast in South Africa while he was in South Africa?
No, apparently in Bombay, he was staying in a place called Gurgaon. And from Gurgaon to the High Court, he would walk every day. It would take 45 minutes one way. And he says that, I advise all lawyers to every day walk to the court and walk back, because you're not going to have time for exercise. He says every time thereafter, whether in India or South Africa, he would always walk from wherever he was to the court and back. And that he then followed throughout his life and walked very quickly.
In fact, sir, I had occasion to visit South Africa. So there were two places which I had occasion to go. One is the Gandhi House, which is on the outskirts of Johannesburg. From there to the court chambers, which is now known as the Gandhi Square, is about, say, 18 kilometers or something. So he would walk from his Gandhi House to this place every day in the morning, and then go back around 4 o'clock. After some time, he got a place called Tolstoy Farms, which was again 34 to 38 kilometers. I went there, it took me about 25 minutes by car. And I was told that he had his office there, and from there, he would start at 7:30 in the morning, reach the court chambers at around 10:30, and then leave again at 3:30 and reach home by 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
So every day for about good 1 year, he would walk about 60 to 65 kilometers unless on
so the he way says, he during all those years as a lawyer, doesn't remember a single day when he was down ill with any illness.
Yes.
He says this walking alone ensured that he never fell ill. So that is something that he strongly believed in.
Deviating from the topic.
Yes.
Could you please share your experience from this table to the sitting as it has done?
Later, over a cup of tea.
Any question? No, it's not a question. Please.
Just referred. The Chief Justice asked Mr. Gandhi to get a certificate from the community. I just want the reference.
It's there in the man behind the Mahatma.
Thank you.
It's Charles DeSalvo, man behind the Mahatma.
Now there is a practice, the politicians are also practicing in court. Why not Gandhi followed this path? While joining the politics, he did not practice. Now we have both. What could be the reason?
It's an interesting question. In fact, even I wonder why Gandhi gave up practicing in India altogether. I think he would have made a remarkable lawyer had he come back to India. But I think it was a conscious choice because of the suffering that he saw. Every time he came to the Congress meetings and then he travelled third class, I think that affected him very deeply, how Indians were suffering. He had this, what disturbed him very deeply was the dirtiness, the uncleanliness and the caste system. So the untouchability, all that really, really mattered to him. So
either we got a good lawyer or we got independence.
As a continuation of that, the first South African constitutional court had stalwarts of their freedom movement. Like Albi Sachs was very much part of the African National Congress. Arthur Chaskalson defended Mandela in the Rivonia trial as a lawyer. So these were two leading lights, and even Zach Yaqub was a freedom fighter, part of the ANC. So these are people who sat first in the constitutional court in South Africa. So you'll find the quality of jurisprudence that has come from the South African constitutional court very rich, because it's come from a lived experience of, you know, politics. Yes. So that, I think, somehow we were unfortunate not to have. Yes. I would think it's a misfortune. I don't know what Mr. Basant or Mr. Karpovi Nayakam will say, but I think it makes a huge difference, which is why the quality of writing of a Krishna Iyer is different. Because of Krishna has lived life in politics. There is something that when you are active in politics, like Justice Hegde. So when you are active life in politics and then you come onto the bench, there is a certain quality you bring with it which was lacking. We were a very much conservative court because we didn't have the courage and the, you know, spontaneity that people in politics may have had. So this is something that we need to reflect on.
Sir, one second. After the second. Please, ask.
Sir, I have one question.
Actually, Justice Karpovi Vinayakam himself is a product of politics. He doesn't tell you that. Correct?
Yeah, please.
I have one question which is not related to topic. My question is, why the Indian people does not follow the Gandhi philosophy, which is follow the advanced country?
I'm not prepared to agree with you at all. Yeah. I think a lot of Indians in smaller pockets are steadfastly adopting the Gandhian philosophy. Only they are not visible to you. Yes. If you look into the smaller places in India, you'll find people adopting passive resistance.
There's a village in Jharkhand.
The farmers from Tamil Nadu who are in Jantar Mantar are following the Gandhian philosophy. Yes. They have not taken to arms. They have a passive resistance. Iram Sharmila struggle is again one of passive resistance. So there are many pockets in India where you'll find people adopt a certain Gandhian philosophy to their approach. They are not in large numbers for you to notice, but they are there. So when that number swells, then we'll have a better India. Sure.
Can I expect some suggestion? This answer, my question is also about in this. But what is the judiciary?
I think one thing that Gandhi's life tells us. Yeah, I think
it's of Mahatma Gandhi. It is the main question.
Yeah, I'll tell you.
Answer is right. Earlier to.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let me answer your question straight away. Gandhi was not a follower. He was a leader. So what Gandhi is telling you, at a personal level, you set your standards and set them high. And once you are able to, at a personal level, transform yourself, things around you will react to that transformation and transform themselves. If you expect everyone to say, okay, this is what Gandhi said, I'm going to start following this from tomorrow, it may not quite happen. Because that internal transformation is some personal lived experience. So it is a constant engaging with yourself, with your own demons.
And also now, all over the world, the large number of the statues are Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, not even the Mahatma Gandhi, he said. This is known to all. So what is your suggestion in this respect? Why this world community?
See, this is also our own, pedestalizing. See, someone whom we are unable to follow, it's easy to put them on a pedestal and say, Gandhi can do it, I cannot do it. But I'll bow down to him, I'll garland him on October 2nd. But Gandhi himself didn't want us to do that. Like Buddha didn't want his sleeping Buddha, standing Buddha, golden Buddha, he didn't want all these Buddhas. He wanted people to follow the Buddhist truths. So somewhere, I think, we make it very convenient for ourselves to have statues. I think two legends of Indian law, and I'm glad you mentioned that, two legends of Indian law which I would put to the highest, one is definitely Gandhi, the other is Ambedkar. I think their contribution to the development of Indian law has not been acknowledged enough. the kind of provisions that are in the Indian constitution, whether it could have come about without an Ambedkar is anybody's guess. Like Article 17 or Article 23 or 24. I don't think these were written exclusively with the Indian constitution. Which other Indian, with the other constitution, the world talks of untouchability, talks of it as an offense. So it's a remarkable contribution that these two stalwarts have made. They never agreed with each other. They had very, very strong, sharp differences. Sometimes irreconcilable differences.
That too again because Dr. Ambedkar also lived that kind
of... But they were tall, very tall because of their lived experience. And Ambedkar was actually a man of economics. He was a double PhD in economics, who also was a bar at law. And they were steeped in proper learning, education and professionalism. I think on that there should be no compromise at all. You must learn your law, you must learn your procedure, you must know your courts. There is no compromise on that. It's not enough to have emotion and rhetoric in court. It's not enough to make a political speech in court. At the end of the day, you have to satisfy the judge that you have a case. So,
lady advocates.
Yes. Which is why Gandhi was very courteous to judges. He knew their limitations and he said, this is all that I know you can do. Well, you do what you do.
Delhi in SLP court, we are lovely.
That's the Gandhian experience. Give any answer to many a young man in the profession who finds the conflict between truth, ethicality and the practice.
See,
I can understand Gandhi, we opted for mediation, negotiated settlement, as a different ballgame altogether. But as a downright practicing lawyer, the conflict between, the ethical conflict between right and wrong, which is, I would think, is no other for any other profession. A doctor, so long as he's honest to himself, doesn't have a problem. A teacher doesn't have a problem. But a lawyer does have a problem of conflict between right and wrong, ethicality, which I talk to many of the young people here, I find they have the same problem which I faced in the law college, perhaps, you know. And therefore, I've been trying to say that I will opt for truth as I perceive it. Would that apply to a practicing lawyer? Is it possible for our young people to emulate that model at all as downright practitioners?
Actually, this is a very hard, tough path that Gandhi takes. When he talks of his personal conviction about, you know, truth not being compromised in court. He doesn't say that you should compromise the case of your client, but you should uphold the truth. So you will not yourself contribute to promoting the untruth in court. So there's a very fine line, which is what I'm saying. There's a very fine line. Let's just take a typical criminal case. You have a right of silence. And that's the dilemma that most lawyers face. Criminal cases is where they face the dilemma. So the dilemma that is faced by these people was also faced by Gandhi. Where he says that the minute I know that there's untruth being spoken, I will stop participating. Now that is a great sacrifice and challenge you may have to make at a personal level as a lawyer. So if you're prepared to make it, you will rest with an easy conscience. But this is something personal to you. So this is something as a lawyer you'll have to tell yourself. I would see it like this. As a lawyer, everybody has a defense in a court. And your role is to provide that defense. Your role is not to distort the truth, but to make sure that whatever case the person has before a court is put forth before the court.
Is that part of the lawyer's ethical existence?
Yes, because...
That you should project
the
truth
you're not
in,
a judge.
In a criminal trial.
Yes, because the lawyer is not the judge.
See, as a judge it's much easier. You're always looking at truth and justice.
Yes.
But as a practicing lawyer, I always find, is that possible?
No, you put forth whatever case your client has, which is possible to be put forth before the court, and let the court decide it. A typical case of murder and culpable homicide. This is something that you will ask the judge to decide.
You would never dispute a true fact then. The argument that there is no evidence would perhaps vanish.
We don't know. Because there will be right to silence. There will be a right to silence. And there will be a procedure. And you will not compromise on procedure. You will, as a lawyer, argue that this is the procedure established by law and this procedure has to be followed. So on that, you will be very strong. On what should be the defense taken, that is a strategy that you evolve as a lawyer. And that is only something that you yourself know. So that is where you cross the line, whether you're creating falsehood and defending falsehood, or you're not putting that falsehood forward. That is the fine distinction that the lawyer has to, that decision the lawyer has to make. And the lawyer has to have a conscience which will permit him, you know, to do certain things which might end up his losing the case or losing the client. And he should be able to tell the client, this is all I can do and this is what I cannot do. That decision the lawyer has to make. And Gandhi has been very steadfast on that. If you do A, B, C and D, I'll appear for you. If you're not prepared to do A, B, C and D, I'm not appearing for you. So this is at a personal level as a lawyer, you draw the line.
Shimona, please. Wait. Shimona.
Actually, following through on this very conversation that is happening, I wanted to share with you that yesterday I had gone to give a small lecture to students of 11 and 12 in a school. And this is really one of the things that we talked about, and I shared with them how you had actually spoken to me as your junior when I came to you for the very first time, that very first hour that I spent with you, in which you said two things to me, which you also in some ways repeated here, and I was able to share with the students yesterday. One is that to be an honest lawyer and to be committed to the truth, success will come to you, and but it may come slowly, but it will come. The second thing is of course about setting standards for yourself, which are your own standards, and then being true to those standards. And I just sort of reflecting on what you've spoken today and how important it is for our young people to have these very visible role models, because young people are full of idealism and full of energy, and but they really do perceive the legal profession from what is happening in popular media.
No, so because it's treated as a combat. You see,
no,
it's
not
about
just that,
succeeding in, you know, a duel.
Not just that, this whole thing about the lawyer being the either the jolly LLB or the suits or how to get away with murder. You know, these popular representations of lawyers are so damaging to our profession. And I think it's really important that what you have spoken about actually is not just written about in a book, but also becomes accessible to youngsters.
In fact, if the lawyer sees the role as a participant in the seeking of truth, then the whole approach will be very different. That what should come out of this trial must be the triumph of truth, right? Let's say that is the bare minimum. So if you shape yourself as a lawyer in that mold, then automatically some things will get answered. Then you will not bend to somehow rescue by falsehood. That client will go to that lawyer who's prepared to do it. He will not come to you. That's okay. Because you are a lawyer who believes in this. That is what is important. This man tells us, Gandhi tells us this, that you have to set your standards and to stand by those standards. If on that everybody starts compromising, it's about pouring milk into the tank when everybody says, no, let me pour water because the other guy is going to pour milk. What you have is an entire tank of water. So it's like that. So you be clear in your mind as a lawyer that this is how far I will go and this is what I will not do. That is very, very important.
Yeah.
It takes a lot of courage and it takes a lot of perseverance.
1 minute, Mugli. I request, Rana Mukherjee will give a vote of thanks.
Fortunately, Murli, I call him Murli. I won't call him Justice Murli.
I think all of
he is just a judge between 10:30 and 4:30. That's our greatest boon. And I hope he continues the same vein. And we learn. It's a pleasure appearing before him. It's a pleasure being his friend too. When he was here, I'm still a friend of his. But our meetings are far and few in between. Money was never important for him. It was important for living a good life. And that is something which everyone should know. These gowns, these come and go. What we need is, when you turn around, people still respect you. And that is what he's earning every day by a great degree. And so we are very happy you're here. And maybe we'll get you back again.
Can you
give
his book, please?
Yes. And Narasimha, I think Narasimha, Murli, me, Mohana and all, we came together at the others are also here, but we are always here together at the same time. So keep on the good work, I can really say that. Thank you so much.
Okay, we will take your autograph.
Sure.
Please, quickly. Those who are not signed, kindly sign in the canteen at least.
I'm listening to you, get enlightened.
No, now since he's a judge, he needs water. Earlier when you argued,
correct.
Particularly the topic was so interesting. Topic, routine legal topic.
Yes, yes, of course he will be here for coffee.
But the other thing I wanted to mention to all of you who are in PIL, see, when he did his test litigation, he picked up the wealthiest of his community, the most influential persons of his community, and not just about any ordinary person. I think that is also very important as a strategy. Who do you put forth?
He also had to suffer his their form of Aadhaar.
No, but he was very clear. You see, this self-esteem and dignity. That's another very thing, something very strong with him. So, which is why he protested.
There is one saying, keep it in Gandhi's account.
What is it? You write here, last you can write. Each name, whatever. And you make some
good words for us.
Some more.
Those
some
who are not signed, kindly sign and go. And join for a cup of tea, please, all of you. It will come, register will come. Where somebody kept actually with them, that's the whole trouble.
I didn't come. I usually didn't
come. They kept it themselves somewhere.
They're so engrossed in their offense. They didn't realize this.
You
should all thank Seshu also for coming.
I'm so sorry. It is Seshu who's continuing and he'll continue because and that's a very good thing for young lawyers. This continuing the Friday club.
Now this being the 50th Friday, I think he'll legitimately deserve a standing
ovation. Mukherjee will read it. Everything you take,
This, yes.
Please, wait a little aloud. Well, okay. Come closely.
Delighted to be sharing these precious moments with all of you. Energizing, inspiring to carry on. Warm wishes.
Thank you. Join for cup of tea. Rana is hosting for everything.
So and so likely to get convicted, so and so likely to get acquitted. And it was always right. He said, how is it possible? I take so much precaution. And you know, I myself bring it in my own briefcase, combination lock, put it in the suitcase. Something was wrong with him. So inquiry. So the entire inquiry ended up with this usher, man who pulls his chair and brings him in. He said, you've been opening my briefcase. He says, no, I don't even know how to open those combinations. How is it possible that you were able to find out? He said, no sir, the view is very simple. While you're hearing the case, the minute you have any doubts and you're going to acquit, you start rubbing your mushy. But the minute you're going to convict, you start rolling your
No, just now, sir. Let's get it.